We're 2 seconds in. You're already looking at your watch. What's that all about? What's that all about? I just saw that. I just saw you look at the watch.
I did. I got a text message. It's these Apple watches.
Oh, I forgot you're fancy.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah,
this Apple. Is a historic day in Las Vegas. Big. Gio's going to lose his mind today. Big. This might be the biggest day of your life.
Could be.
Right?
After birth? Yeah.
I mean, the Raiders are playing their first football game in Las Vegas as... Well, first football game total for them, but the Las Vegas Raiders, and sitting to my left. Look at him. He's so happy.
He's like a kid in a candy
sitting
store
my
right
left.
Now.
I mean, I was in the store. We were in the store yesterday, and we're looking for these jerseys. Happened to be this guy named Marcus Allen's jerseys. And I asked the kid, I said, "Do you have Marcus Allen jerseys?" And he's like, No, we don't have any Marcus Allen jerseys. And I go, "You know who he is, right?" And he's like, "Yeah, that old Raider." And I'm like, "What?" I said, "You mean the Hall of Fame Raider?" And John's like, "Go easy,
yeah,
Gio."
I'm like, "Don't go hurt easy. The kid was 21. Give him a break, right?"
That could be two truths.
True. Yeah, true that.
I don't know. I'm the Raider, obviously I am. So
you look like you could still jump on the field.
Looks who deceive
me,
my
Let
friend.
Me ask you this. If you trained for, let's say, 9 months,
yes,
could you take it to
no,
the house?
I gave you the answer. Yes, I can play.
You could. Yes. I know you could.
Is that yes, because the game has changed, or you could still do it?
That's because I can still do it. If I really, you know, listen, how long could I do it? Obviously not.
For a game.
Like I used to.
Right.
But I certainly still have, you know, I still run. I'm in decent shape and stuff, but if I really worked out like I used to, I know that people, you know, it sounds crazy, but I certainly think that I can.
Well, the Giants are looking for a running back after
yeah,
yesterday.
Well,
so
that kind of,
yeah,
that was sort of sad to see because he's one of my favorite running backs.
Oh, absolutely.
I've enjoyed him for a long time since he was at Penn State. And I saw what he did to my USC team, and and then he, you know, emerged as one of the top running backs in the league. For the Giants, and was sad to see him go down because yeah. He's such a talent, you know. I mean, he's one of the guys, that's the reason you watch the game, because what he's able to do every time he touches the ball, so it's great.
Yeah.
You never really had any injury issues, did you?
I have, it's interesting, you guys were talking about making a cast out there of
yeah.
me, of my hands rather, and stuff, and my hands are pretty beat up. I got a finger over here. This happened in 1985 against the Atlanta Falcons. And this happened in practice. The tip of my finger, wasn't paying attention. A football hit the tip of it, bent it down. And it never, you know, obviously, again, was able to straighten out. I broke my wrist and had 3 knee injuries, but none that ever required surgery. And have
wow.
A right arm that doesn't straighten out.
Really?
And after 16 years, that is a blessing.
A blessing?
No, I mean, the amount
oh,
of...
Oh, you know, I thought you meant that your right arm didn't
no,
straighten
no,
out. I was
yeah.
like, what?
Yeah, I mean, to walk away from the game after
yeah.
16 years, after, let's say, I don't know, a million car crashes, to be able to walk away is a...
Right.
Yeah,
because
you don't even walk like many retired guys walk. Like you walk like everything. Nothing
Earl
hurts.
Campbell,
I have no,
like,
no knee problems, no hip problems. You know,
Monty
Groh. God has been good. So
Monty Groh, who played with you in
Kansas City, yeah,
you know, Carol's ex now yeah. ex-husband. He told me years ago, probably 15 years ago. I don't even remember what brought it up, but he's like. They were just talking about practice and pain and, you know, daily grind of being a football player. And he's like, Marcus Allen is a freak. He's like, Marcus Allen, first of all, jumps in that ice bath. like most guys, it's like a toe. It's a process. Like, is
right.
it so
no,
cold?
No,
it
took
Kevin Hart getting
really
that
got in there. Yes.
But he says you sit in there and you just sit in there.
Well, yes, I do sit in it. That was one of my, you know, I think tricks to recover. After a physical game and stuff, jump in the ice bath, And, you know, like most guys, they would come around and mess with you while you were in there and stuff, right? Because once you settle in, you're fine. But if you, you know, if you happen to move, you know,
you're free.
Yeah, you're all over again. So, you know, guys would always do that. But, you know, I practiced hard. You know, I practiced hard. I'd like to think, and I'm sure maybe, you know, maybe once or twice it didn't happen, but I think every time I touched the ball, I ran the ball 40 yards or more down the field. Every time I touched it for 16 years. So I learned that at USC. So for 20 years, every time I touched the ball, you know, it would be, you know, 40 yards or more down the field. And that was one of the reasons I played so long, in addition to just being a very, very smart player. And I like to think that I was talented. I like to think that I was gifted, but I really had a passion about it, and I really worked hard. I mean, a lot of people see the trophies, they see the awards and things, but they very seldom see how much work you put in. Mm-hmm, and, right. You know, a lot of my friends were obviously hanging out, having a good time, you know, whether it was putting on combat boots, whether it was pushing cars, whether it was running up hills. I mean, I ran all day long.
Really?
Yes.
In the off season.
Well, let me let me tell you what I did. I was one of those people. I like to think that I was really smart in this regard. I listened to my body. After every season, you know, things have changed. Then, right? We just had a training camp. We'd had a mini camp, a training camp, and then guys would disappear and they would come back. And then we have obviously, you know, we come back for the season and stuff. And we had that training camp, but. I always felt that it's a physically, emotionally demanding game. You got to get away from it. Mm. So I did nothing. After the last game of the year, I did nothing for 3 months. I just made sure I didn't gain weight.
Is that hard to do?
No.
Not eat yourself into oblivion?
Well, no.
Because you can gain 1 month of quarantine did me in for 20 pounds.
Well, no. I mean, at the most, I gain is 7. So that's so easy to lose. So, I mean, I don't, you know, I don't consider that, you know, gaining weight, really. Right. You know, that's just sort of normal, I think. You know, I think the biggest challenge, especially with guys that are, you know, big, is during the offseason, they can gain 30 pounds and stuff. And it's tough to work that off.
Because in camp, you're just getting back to ground zero, right?
Yeah, so I never really sort of, you know, gained a lot of weight and stuff, so it was easy for me to get back into shape and stuff like that. And then there was always something forward, you know, to look forward to, right? Now that's like, it's year-round, Dale. So, I mean, you're like, I think you get sick and tired of seeing guys all the time because, you know, these OTAs are like, you know, like a week later after the season starts, you got to go back up there and stuff. And we got away. And so when we came back to camp, it was like, you know, man, dude, man, good seeing you. I haven't seen you forever, you know, as opposed to seeing you every single day, you know, and I can't stand your face anymore. That kind of thing. So,
what do you think about the this season, the no preseason games? Would you have liked that, like as a rule, no preseason games?
I think you need it. I think for the quality of play, I think you need it. And I think to hone your skill. You know, I think they used to do 6, then they went to 4, and now I think obviously because of COVID, I think they're this is you know clearly an aberration because you know
they want the revenue.
Yes, they certainly do want the revenue, and they're going to get a couple of free games where they make a lot of money. So, but overall, I think you know I prepared hard at practice and stuff and. I only needed a few plays during the preseason. Yeah, I didn't need to be in there because I worked hard all the time. So as far as getting my timing and everything like that, I did that at practice. I mean, I would go full speed, and so it was, you know, for some people, I think they need more, and some they need less. It all depends on the individual.
Do you think you had that kind of killer mentality like Kobe, and like? You know, made it about the main thing, like you weren't really distracted about everything else. You were like, I'm going to work on my craft during your career.
I talked to Jim Brown once, and one of the things he said to me was, don't be cool, right? And so I never thought, you know, much about what anybody else thought about what I was doing. I was working on my skill. I was honing my craft. I was getting ready. You know, I visualized all that while I was playing. And even as a young kid, guys, I tell the story, man, when I was 10 years old, I said, I made a decision what side of the television set I wanted to be on. I said, I want to play and not watch, right?
I had that same thought. Yeah. It never happened.
And then, Gio, I see you in the screen. Yeah.
Well, I was going to be the starting shortstop for the Dodgers until I wasn't.
Newsflash.
Well, for me, it's kind of worked out.
Yeah.
So, then at 11, I said I want to win the Heisman Trophy and stuff. And so I'm one of those guys who like lived the secret before the book was written. You know? I was knowing all this stuff out in the universe, and I even had a speech. You know, I would stand in front of the mirror and thank everybody, thank my school and stuff, because I always was going to USC. Thank my parents, you know, for when they helped me win the Heisman Trophy. I did that as a young kid, so, but I always worked hard, you know. I understood there was nothing free. Later, the expression "a free lunch costs $1.99," you know, I use today and stuff. But I always knew like nobody was going to give you anything, and you know, you had to work for it and stuff. So, but I'm one of the lucky ones, guys. When I look back and reflect and stuff, and you're talking about, you know, I think we talked about brotherhood yesterday and stuff, and I had cheerleaders at home, man. I didn't have parents that booed me. Didn't tell me I couldn't do anything.
And that's important.
They told me I could do everything.
Nice.
Right? And so I thought skies was the limit, man, because I had parents that reinforced that, that loved me to death and told me I can be anything I want, you know, just as long as I work hard and stuff. So I had cheerleaders at home. I had great supporters.
And along the way, when you like first step on the field at SC, when you win the Heisman, when you get drafted, when your first day stepping on the field in the NFL, do you have all these like "holy shit, I did it" moments, or do you just take it as it comes and you just always looking to the next?
No, I mean it was just always a step to where I wanted to go, and it was always a part of my vision, my plan, you know. Again, when you sort of, you know, it's funny. I used to lose my shoes and stuff, so I couldn't go to church and stuff. Mom, I can't find my shoes. I don't know where they are. I'll just stay home and watch the football game. Right? And so I used to do that. I mean, I was into it. I loved it and stuff. And I knew everything about the players and what colleges they went to. And I mean, I studied as a young kid, and so I was. You know, I mean, it wasn't a surprise to me that that when I look back, that it all happened, because I sort of, you know, saw it, visualized it, worked at it. I saw the flex muscles in my dream, and they started to take shape and form, and it became a reality and stuff. And but the other part of that is like I wanted that, but I also, and I think, you know, it happens when you something becomes larger than just you. I wanted it for my parents. So I always wanted to honor my parents, man. Yeah. It's like, you know, they were just, and they still are, man. I mean, they're just the most amazing people and stuff. So,
How old were you when you first had a football in your hand, or do you remember?
Oh, no, let me, well, the first sport we played was baseball.
Okay.
And I remember playing baseball in the backyard. I had to be like 3 or something like that. I don't know, 4 maybe, 5? I'm not quite sure. Because the one thing I do remember, for some reason, guys, this is really weird. The one thing I remember more than anything, and I do remember getting hitting in the eye, I was the catcher. And somebody was pitching, and I didn't have a mask on, right?
Oh, man.
They threw it and it hit me. I think a foul tipped me, hit me right in the eye. I was like, ah! Right?
Get this.
Yeah. No, I mean, but that's one thing I remember. And I do remember, guys, I know this is really weird, the watching the Kennedy funeral, JFK, for some reason. And maybe I recognized early on that my parents were, you know, sad and stuff, what happened, and sort of like in our black and white Magnavox, man. I was watching, at 3 years old, watching the funeral procession, you know? So those are really the two things that I really remember at a really young age.
Imagine if he played baseball, he'd still be
man,
playing.
He would.
I always thought about that, man. It's like, man, that was like, golly, baseball players, man. And they.
It's crazy.
I went to a spring training once, and I mean, what they have to do is like, it's ridiculous.
You went to actually like play and go through the motions with them?
No, no, no. My brother was out there, Damon.
Okay.
Yeah. They signed him to pitch. I mean, he hadn't, you know, he had been playing football, and he was a pitcher at Cal State Fullerton. They won the World Series there in college and stuff like that. And he hadn't pitched for 10 years, and they still signed him and stuff like that.
Wow.
So he was, and so I went down to see him and stuff. But then I saw guys just jogging in the outfield was there to take batting practice, yeah. And they were jogging the outfield from silent.
And you wonder why he wanted to play baseball.
Like, oh,
I mean,
my God, I could have played this thing. I could still be playing, right?
Sure. What are you guys doing?
Yeah.
Thought you guys were athletes. What's happening here?
I still got bat speed. Come on. I can hit the curveball.
Albert Pujols just like broke whose record?
Willie Mays. Yeah.
And he can barely run to first base.
I know.
And he's making like $30 million.
It reminds me of like the weekend softball league where, you know, somebody hits and then somebody else has to run to first base and tag out, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, he signed a long term deal, so they got
they're gonna get every ounce of Albert they can get.
When he left the Cardinals, that was
yeah.
Man.
Do you miss it?
No. John, no. You guys got to understand, when you play 16 years.
Right. You did it.
You get it all out your system, man.
Right.
Because, you know, the average of my position, well.
That's unheard of.
That was a while ago. Yeah. Well, the only person that's approaching it now, I don't know if he surpassed me, is Frank Gore, right?
Yeah.
But most guys don't play that long. So I got it all out my system and stuff. As a matter of fact, the Chiefs wanted me to play again, but I said that was enough. Because, you know, intellectually, you know, you can't play forever. Monetarily, you want to.
Right.
But physically, you know, you can't. So.
Right.
And Frank Gore's starting now.
Yeah, and emotionally, it's what you've been doing since you were a kid. So at some point, you know, you gotta step away from it. And, you know.
And then when you do you have that element of, like, now what?
No, I didn't have that element of now what. I had that element of, oh, I forgot, man, these, you know, I get to enjoy a holiday.
I
get time
and
to spend with my family.
And you're still young. You retired. You're, what, 40?
37.
37, okay.
Yeah. So started 22, 37, played 16.
Amazing.
So, yeah.
And now, what's the day in the life of Mark Salen like?
I got a six-year-old. Best thing in the world.
Fatherhood.
Best thing in the world, dude.
Now, will your son play football if he decides?
I will let my son do what he wants to do. I mean, I think as a parent, my job is to inform him and give him all the information so he can make a prudent decision.
But like your parents, you'll be his cheerleader.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. I tell him he can do anything.
Is he into sports yet?
Golf.
Golf?
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
He golfs, right?
The next Tiger Woods.
The next Tiger Woods, yeah.
So, you won't ever hear me saying, you know, we'll try to use the, you know, avoid using the word can't around the house. And, you can do anything, and that's what he needs to hear and stuff. And far too often, I think, in a lot of our communities and stuff, they're told they're, you know, they won't amount to anything, and, you know, unfortunately, they believe it.
Yeah.
And if you don't have that support in your household and in your community and stuff like that, and if you're constantly, you know, hear negative things about, you know, your inability to make it in life. Unfortunately, you know.
It's hard enough to make it with positive things.
It is. I mean, well, you know what? It's I just think the human, you know, mind is the greatest thing. And I think you know, we can create and if we put the work into it, whatever life that we want, you know, we always talk about you know, this is your motion picture, right?
Right.
And you decide, obviously, what kind of picture you want, you know? And you have your leading people in your life, and those are the important people. And you have your, you know, you have a bunch of impactful people, you know, that are, you know, besides your parents and stuff like that, and your wife or something like that. And then you got these incredible people in your life. I'm sure, like, Jill is probably one of them that's impacted your life in such a positive way.
Yeah,
those
for
are
sure.
And then there's a bunch of extras, you know. I think far too often we spend too much time.
Adam's an extra.
I think far too often we spend too much time on the extras.
It was like an alley oop.
I had to dunk that. The people that matter. I do give up good assist every now and then. Yeah. So
go ahead.
I can't. I just had a question. You know, we talked about playing for the Chiefs, playing for the Raiders, you know, the experience of the Coliseum, the experience of Arrowhead Stadium. What is that like as a player to walk out in that?
Well, it's great. First of all, I mean, you know, one, I love to play anyway. I always want to honor my parents, right? So that's all those were the only people that I needed to see, my family, my brothers and sister. And that was really it. And I can go. And then it's just icing on the cake when you have a fan support that really, 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 really supports you and are behind you, you know, and not fair weather, but they're just like, they're there, and you know you can count on them. It's just a great feeling. And to hear the rise of the crowd after you do something special or your team does something, it's just great. And the energy is just unbelievable. I mean, it's like an avalanche. When it starts to roll, there's nothing that can stop it. Hmm. So it's a lot of fun. And you know, it's got to be challenging. You know, it's nothing more than a practice game right now. Those guys playing against each other, mm-hmm. then bringing the crowd in, it's a completely different story. I mean, emotions,
nerves,
you know, change, yeah, everything. You know, so and once the fans get behind you or against you, it's, you know, it could be difficult and it can be great.
And that was leads to the next question. How difficult would it be to play in these empty stadiums now? I mean,
I think it's challenging. Yeah. It's got to be tough. I mean, but, you know, they're like scrimmages. And,
right.
And if you really sort of, meaningful scrimmages.
Right, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So, but if you really a professional, you're going to take advantage of this. Right. You're going to work hard. I mean, which you always do anyway now. So, hopefully fans will come back soon and, you know, the stadiums will be full and we'll return to normal and
stuff. Which is weird because Gio and I were talking about, we've talked about this several times.
Dallas had like 22,000.
Yeah, Dallas had like 22,000 people in the
stadium. Claudia Jordan went to the game yesterday. I saw on her Instagram.
And no one was practicing social distancing.
No, and in Kansas City they had people, you know. And,
yeah, well, some teams have decided to have some. I think, you know, in talking to Mark Davis, he felt strongly. It's like he could not tell, you know, you can go and you can't. And he just didn't,
so he just said nobody comes.
Yeah, he just didn't like that. So I mean, that was I was with him for and talked to him for a while, guys. And this troubled him.
Yeah,
this really did. I mean, this ate at him and stuff. And because what Mark has done is done. He's done it. What he's created here is for Raider Nation. Really, I mean, Mark is a fan. He's an owner,
right.
But he's a fan. And so he's tried to create this incredible, you know, environment for the fans. And the fact that they can't, you know, due to, you know, this pandemic, they can't enjoy it really bothers him. So
Let me ask you this. How did he react when you said, I understand that, but I have to bring Jono, Adam, and Gio with me to the opener? What did he say?
I'm the extra, by the way.
He said, were they former players? I said, yeah. I said, okay, all of them.
Yeah. I love the fact
they were free agent pickup.
Yeah, exactly.
Remember
right. we were mistaken for Raiders players at a restaurant not too long ago.
I was mistaken.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. I was sure mistaken for somebody else. But no, I love how Mark's been so involved with the Las Vegas community as well. Since the Raiders came, I mean, going to those Golden Knights games, and he loves this city.
Yeah, he really does. I mean, he's embraced it. He wants to be a part of it and stuff. And the fact that, I mean, he really has built a relationship with the Golden Knights, and it's important to him. It's not just, it's not just something that's disingenuous. This is important to him. He likes supporting the other professional team. He wants them to come to our game. He wants one big family here in the city of Las Vegas. He's working at it. And I was telling, I forgot who I was talking to, but a friend of mine, I was saying, you know what? A lot of people underestimated Mark. But what he's done is amazing. I mean, that stadium is beautiful.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Right?
Death Star.
From the outside, it looks great. You know, I couldn't tell you what it looks like from the inside. You know,
and you were telling me something interesting yesterday that the actual grass, they roll in.
It's outside. Yes. Yeah, like Arizona.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Crazy.
That's nice.
Yeah.
And for UNLV games, it's artificial turf, and then for Raiders games, it's natural grass.
Mm. Mm. Do you like playing on artificial turf or?
Not really.
It's brutal on the knees, right?
Well, you guys, you know, obviously the fact that I played much, you know, long ago. Is yeah, there's a big difference. Field turf now is a lot easier in the body and stuff. And we were actually just playing on cement with.
You mean going to the Astrodome and you know
one of the worst places in the world.
Yeah, absolutely.
There were I think Philadelphia and the Houston Astrodome were the worst. I mean, they had seams out there because of the baseball diamond underneath. You could twist an ankle in a seam out there. I got hurt in Houston. I just made a cut and popped my posterior.
Wow.
You know, it's like, are you serious? And it was hard too. Turf is hard. I mean, it just, for those who played on it for a long, long time, you know, my heart, you know, my,
yeah.
I tip my hat to those guys. When I went to Kansas City, one of the selling points were, we're going to, go to natural grass. I said, okay, right?
Otherwise, not going to happen, right?
Well, no, listen here. This is the funny thing, right? I Marty Schottenheimer called me almost every day. Almost every day. Then he called me and they told me they signed Joe Montana. Ooh. Right? And I go like, So... he calls me every day. He signed you with Montana. They're going to natural grass. And we're like, duh.
Yeah.
You know, it was just, you know, and I was 33 years old at the time, right? And you know, that age, I'm supposed to be washed up. I'm no longer supposed to be a player that can produce and stuff like that. So I was like, well, I knew that was a lie, but... I said, you know what? Let's go. Let's go to Kansas City. I mean, here's a guy who wants me. He's calling me every single day. And I'm not talking about, I'm not joking when I say that. He called me every single day.
Wow.
And comeback player of the year that first season.
Yes.
Just great. Wow. That's.
Yeah, I scored 15 touchdowns and comeback player of the year. So I'm the only player in NFL history. I guess that is one Heisman, a rookie of the year, which is always the hardest thing to do because you only get 1 year to win that, right?
Right.
Super Bowl MVP, league MVP, comeback player of the year, and
not to mention national championship and Super Bowl champion on top of that.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I don't want to brag.
So, no, it's like, you know, I think about it, it's like, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's past pretty cool.
Let's talk about that Super Bowl. Yeah. I was going to Howard University. I was in D.C.
Oh, you were?
Oh, man,
I'm so sorry.
Oh, no.
Oh, so you were a fan then?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. He's from L.A.
Born and raised.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So, okay, you're all the way to Howard. So, naturally in that area. So, I'm thinking that you're pulling for the Redskins.
I was pulling for you around a bunch of D.C. fans. And it when you took off and ran around and ran into that end zone, I was doing backflips and everyone was, it was the best ever.
Guys, I think most people would think that you're like super nervous before the game, right? And I was not. Matter of fact, I had the greatest night's sleep that you can possibly have. And I got up that morning and I was basically, at least I felt like it, I was walking on air. And for some reason, I was just smiling at everything, right? You know, just smiling. I just smiled, just kept on walking, go to breakfast, came back. And I don't know if you guys know the story, but the Raiders did things differently. You know, a lot of, you know, most teams provide a bus to go to the game, or if you want to go early, back in the day, we took cabs, right? Not Ubers or anything. Like that. We took cabs
those
early
are
to the game.
Those yellow cars that yes. you still see for those
right.
of you
so
listening.
So we took those, yeah. right? And well, the Raiders had for some reason we had like rental cars throughout. So I didn't know any better. I jumped in the rental car with Otis McKinney and I. So we drive to the stadium. And we pull up to the parking attendant, and I said, "Ma'am, excuse me, where do the players park?" And she says, "Well, do you have a parking pass?" And I says, "No." She says, "Well, you can't get in." And I go like, no, ma'am, seriously. Seriously, no. Ma'am, no, seriously.
There's no cell phones in Google.
We're playing, you know, today's game and stuff, and so we play for the Raiders. And we need to get in the stadium. She says, I don't care who you are. You can't get in. And so what I did was I backed the car up and I pulled it against the curb. I looked at Otis. He looked at me. He grabbed his bag. I grabbed my bag. We took off running in the locker room. And to this day, I don't know what happened to the rental car.
Oh, my God. That's incredible.
That's great.
It's a true story. And it's like. You know, it's like, but we had to get in there. I mean, obviously, I just left it there. Now, imagine this was pre-9/11, right?
Right.
Imagine they would have stopped the whole. Yeah, absolutely, yeah. man. So
that's how we're getting to the stadium tonight.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Rent a car, drop it off, and run for it. Got it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they still have cabs here. Yeah. I don't know.
So. What is your, you know, obviously Raiders being here in Las Vegas now, what is your take on Las Vegas as a whole? You know, have you spent a lot of time in the city?
Yes. I've been coming to Las Vegas since I was a kid when they had like nickel pancakes and stuff.
Oh, sure.
Well, we used to sort of drive through and stuff, and this is where, you know, our parents would, stop for a day and stuff. And so it was always nice and stuff, but it's obviously... It was much different then than it is now and stuff. It's amazing. This is probably the entertainment, not probably, but this is the entertainment capital of the world right here.
Oh, absolutely.
So.
And I think we met, the only time I've met you in the past was at the Luxor, the opening of that Hall of Fame thing.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
That happened for a little bit.
Right.
They were like, Warren Moon was there. Yeah, it was a very cool exhibit.
We had a signing and some sort of exhibit there and stuff like that. Matter of fact, I had a couple of things there. I think I don't know if I had my trophy. Yeah,
I want to say it
trophies.
Was.
Yeah, I had a couple of trophies there.
You had
stuff.
A really nice.
Yeah, we loaned them to the museum and stuff like that. So
where are your, you know, you have rings, you have trophies, you have jackets. Where do you, what do you do
and
with
you
all these?
You notice I don't wear anything,
right? Right,
I don't wear rings. I don't wear, I don't know. My little boys, whatever he wants to do with them. You know, the Heisman is his, and all the rest of the trophies and stuff like that. So
that's amazing. That's so cool.
People have offered me to, you know, to buy them, but I went like, that's not mine to sell.
I love that.
Yeah.
Do you think it's going to be harder for players to play here in Vegas, to live in Vegas?
Well, we always thought about initially, I think, everybody was concerned with the
distractions and all that.
Distraction nightlife and...
But I guess it's accessible everywhere, right? I mean, New York is a crazy fun city, L.A., Miami. Like,
come on,
if you want to get into trouble,
no
you can get into
like
trouble,
Vegas,
right?
Come on, seriously. and people are playing downtown.
Right.
And, I mean, you're in the actual, you know, the stadium is actually in Las Vegas and stuff. And most of the places are removed, unless you're in, you know, Madison Square Garden or something like that. That could be a distraction. But and if you live right there, you know, you know, everybody thought perhaps the nightlife would be too much. Gambling would be an issue. If somebody loses money, will they be concerned about, you know, getting that money back as opposed to concentrating on their job and things like that? I mean, those are all the things that I'm sure a lot of people considered, thought about before moving here. So.
And now there's no more nightlife, so then you don't have to worry about that. Right. Can't even get into trouble.
Shut down all the strip clubs.
Yeah,
we're,
don't have to worry about
they're
it.
They're good.
It's all good. Yeah.
So Marcus, you said we. Are you like, are you a Raider Nation, or like, you part of the organization, or are you?
This is one thing that I will always say. Listen here. People always want me to choose, right? And I'll never choose. I embrace both, right? Okay. But if you were to look at my, you know, my career as a Raider, I'm really a Raider. You know what I mean? 11 right. years here, you know, all the things right. that I accomplished here, with the exception of Comeback Player of the Year. So, but I will never, it's like asking you to choose, you know, which child you like the best, right? Because the at 33 and everything that transpired with the Raiders and then leaving, you know, that 5 years were important to me.
Yeah.
You Plus, know, that was a rebirth, and I'm not going to give up that rebirth because you
need right.
not you, no. but I'm saying the general right. public yeah. wants me to make decide. Right. Who I, no, I right. played 16 years. I embraced every single bit of it and stuff. And
do you still go to Chiefs games?
I haven't gone to any games, but I've gone back to alumni. You know, it's my teammates. I like right. some of my teammates, and I have teammates here that I love.
Are you stuff, active so. In the Raiders organization now, like to helping the younger guys or stuff like that, or?
I'm always available to the Raiders anytime they need me. I'm actually, me and Mark talk all the time. And there's always something in the works.
If your relationship with Al Davis was different, do you think you would have stayed with the Raiders for the rest of your career?
Come on, I wouldn't want to retire. And, you know, I was born and raised in San Diego and lucky enough to play at USC. And then, you know, I mean, figure this one out. I mean, how lucky can a guy get? The Raiders I get drafted by, and they move to Los Angeles.
Right, right. So, and you just have to move your locker down the hall a little right. bit.
Absolutely. Yeah. And so my parents make that same, you know, 100 mile drive
yeah.
for almost 16 years.
And now, what, 30 years later, they finally decide to redo yeah. the Coliseum. Of,
yeah,
15 you know.
Years. So, yeah, it's like, so that was a blessing. I mean, yeah. I wish things would have worked out. I wish I, you know, would have stayed in Los Angeles and stuff, but it wasn't meant to be. Just didn't. But the best thing is that we put all this stuff behind us, and you know, I think it's just, you know, everything's positive.
That's awesome.
So yeah,
that's awesome.
Everything's positive. So.
Do you think it's harder to be a player today because of social media and all of that extra exposure that people get?
I'm sure it's challenging, John. But I just think about it. You know, being a professional is, you know, that you don't. You know, just throw that word around lightly and stuff. I mean, professionals do what's necessary. They put everything else, you know, and make it secondary other than family, right? Because we always believe if you play and you play well, all that stuff will take care of itself. Some guys, you know, I think today, unfortunately, are trying to get that outside fame before they take care of the field fame. Mm. It's so easy to do if you just, you know, do what you're supposed to do on the field. And you don't have to promote yourself. The game will promote you in ways that you won't believe. You know what I mean? So it's got to be challenging because this, you know, generation has grown up with, you know, I guess wanting to be liked.
Right.
Wanting to get likes, wanting right. to get followers and stuff mm-hmm. like that and stuff like that. I mean, it's like, that's kind of crazy to me, but.
And when you look at the money that they get paid now, do you shake your head and go like, you got to be kidding me? Like,
well, John, I was one of the, listen here, I mean, obviously we can't, you know.
Different era, would, right?
Yeah, like, there's nothing we can do. And trust me, there were probably guys that came before me who were saying, man, I can't believe the amount of money right. Marcus is making and,
right.
compared to what mm-hmm. they made. And so, but I was one of the players who sued the National Football League for free agency. So they're benefiting for some of the, you know, what I wanted guys to benefit from.
Right.
We didn't want to be trapped to, you know, by one team, and they had your rights, and you can retire like Barry Sanders, and they still had your rights. I mean, that's not, you know, it's not right. It's once your contract is up, you should be able to go to someone who wants to bid for your services and stuff. And before 1993, that wasn't the case.
Hmm. And what do you think about the college players and their rights? Are you what I'm guessing you're on the side of they should get the ability to make money on their name and likeness?
Well, I think people certainly need to or have the ability to you know, monetize their talent, right? College is different. You're getting an education. I mean, we know how valuable the NCAA is, football, and how much money they make that kind of filter out through the entire university, so we know it's important. But it'll be almost, I think it's impossible to almost legislate how do you make it equal, because, you know, today everything has to be fair, right? Right? Yeah, everything has to be fair, you know, we talk about. Yes. So when you try to be fair and there's this one player who isn't playing get the same opportunity as the guy is playing, do we say favored nations or what do we, and it becomes sort of, right. You know, the challenge, I think, of really sort of, you know, making it feasible for teams, right? Because, you know, they still have to, the colleges still have to make money too. The athletic departments still have to make money too. I've always just thought that maybe perhaps they should just, you know, increase the stipend so that way guys feel just a little comfortable.
Right.
And right. So perhaps some guys that, because monetarily some guys have to leave early when they really don't want to, because, you know, their situation isn't great. Not only is their family, so because a lot of guys taking their families into consideration, and so I mean, you can't give everybody $100,000. It just doesn't work. But I just thought, like, you know, just make it more comfortable. When I went to USC, we're living off campus now. We were just given $250 a month, right? Now imagine $250 a month in Los Angeles. That still didn't go anywhere.
Yeah, right.
And how do you legislate the fairness between that, right? Because everything has to be fair, right?
Right.
We go like, well, listen here, $250 is great, man. But $250 is outstanding in Arkansas. Right. But it ain't no.
Right.
You ain't, you're living, right. You know. Yeah. You're not living so well in Los Angeles, $250. That was back then.
Right.
Right.
So it's.
That's crazy.
It's, you know, it's, I believe you can. How do you do it? How does it, you know, how do the universities still make money? How does that apply to the other sports?
Yeah.
It's taking a backseat now, though, because of COVID and not having college football in a lot of cases.
Well, I think it took a backseat, but I think the players now more than ever know that they're a commodity.
Yep.
And I think they're going to, it's not going to just go asleep.
No. There's a reason Pac-12 is talking about coming back and playing, you know.
And I also think that there are ways to, like you said, give them something more. Maybe, like, I like the idea of maybe giving them health insurance for life. I mean, that's, you can't really put a dollar amount on that, but.
How do you pay for that? How do you pay for that and pay for the
other programs,
the other
stipend
and everything else, right? I mean, that's the big challenge.
Good idea.
I guess, yeah, as much as I'd like to think everybody deserves to get paid, you know, the education is supposed to be the trade-off.
But they don't get educated. They don't, they're like, they can if they apply themselves.
Yeah, I was going to say, whose fault is that?
But what if you get cut?
You don't get cut from college.
If you don't, you don't get cut once you get a sponsorship. I mean, you don't get cut. Like if you
when you say sponsorship, what do you
mean? Not sponsorship, about? Scholarship.
You know, I guess I think I've heard on rare occasion I don't know, but most part guys just.
When you have scholarships, don't worry about getting
they
cut.
Get, they well, get yeah. scholarships, and they may never play, but they're still.
You got to mess it up yourself,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I just think it's you know, if you find a way to figure it out where it all makes sense and it's equal to, because everything has to be fair, right?
Right.
You know, we live in this.
Right.
You
correct.
Right. Yeah. So I'm just telling you, man. Right. What do you do, man? Right. It's like, how do you figure it out? You give me a formula, you know, I'll take it upstairs, man.
I just like that he can take it upstairs. What's this list, Adam? What is this list in your hands?
These two claim to be huge Marcus Allen fans.
Oh,
and I was just, you know, something a couple
wait, of wait, 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 wait. We've actually known each other for years.
I know. Okay. Oh, I know. All right, I know. So. But on a
we'll say friends. Right?
Yeah. Let's see here. Let's see here.
Wait. Let me just
a couple true false.
Let me just say one thing though. Remember, I can't even remember what I had for lunch yesterday.
But go ahead.
All right.
So while a standout at Lincoln High School in San Diego,
oh my God,
Marcus was a two-way player and played quarterback on offense. True or false?
True.
It's true. And if there's anything is wrong on these, let me know.
He started off as a DB, right?
Well, that was be my next question.
Okay,
Marcus was recruited to USC as a running back.
You left something out.
What's that?
I was the head coach too.
Were you?
I'm just kidding. In high school.
Yeah, I was also coach.
I
was the Bill Russell of high school.
There you go.
No, just kidding.
Marcus was recruited to USC as a running back.
Marcus was
Yes.
No.
False.
Yeah.
Really?
Defensive back. DB.
DB.
That's
DB.
Right.
I knew this.
So right. What?
One of the most amazing stories ever, guys.
Yeah.
A guy got hurt.
So, John Robbins, how did you get from?
Guys, this is
okay.
Guys, I want you to. We got to take a few steps back,
take
right? And
your
recognize
time.
What USC is at the time.
Mm-hmm.
It is tailback. You, the most popular position in college football. Right.
Right.
USC tailback, the most popular position in all of college football.
Right.
And imagine that I go there as a defensive back. When I get there, all the running backs behind Charles are hurt. And to think perhaps even the during that recruiting year, I don't know who was available, but I'm sure they had to have some of the top, you know, running backs in the country. They were recruiting, but nobody decides to go there that year. And they asked me, because they have nobody to practice behind Charlie, to come over out of the secondary to play running back.
That's so crazy.
So that, you're talking about a blessing. That's out of my hands, man. And that was, you know, God did that. I'm telling
right?
you, yeah.
And were you a fullback before you were?
I was a tailback. I played sparingly. I showed some promise. You know, they put me in last quarter, made some runs, stuff like that. Played very little. Was a special teams guru at the time. And then what happened, which was a compliment, but it was very, very hard. I mean, it was one of the toughest things they had to do. John Robinson said, Marcus, listen here, you're too good an athlete to sit on the bench because you're not going to play in front of Charles, right? Charles White. And so he said, would you play fullback? And I said, yeah. Now, I was only 190 pounds or something like that. And I was going against guys that were 250, 245. Right. Linebackers were bigger then. They're not the same size linebackers they have today that are 210 pounds and stuff like that. So it was a challenge. The first day of practice, the first day of 9-on-7, the first day I ran into Larry McGrew, and Larry weighed 250. I was like 190. Broke my nose.
Really?
Oh.
Blood everywhere.
Wow.
And I'm thinking like, oh, well, I'm done for the day. And my coach, John Jackson, the late John Jackson, who was just awesome, and I love him to death, he says, where are you going? He says, you better get your ass back in there. So, hey.
With a broken nose.
Blood everywhere, yeah. And that was my introduction to never leave the field. I mean, I always thought that way anyway, but that was my introduction to Marcus, never leave the field. I don't care.
Wow.
If you know, there's if something's broke or there's blood all over you or whatever, you don't ever, you never leave the field. You always stay on the field.
How do you feel now about how many black quarterbacks, like it was like amazing last night seeing Russell Wilson and Cam Newton in the late game, like big time guys playing quarterback and just doing amazing things. Like, is I know coming from where we came from, where black quarterbacks were scarce, and now how it's changed. What do you feel about that?
I don't even look at them as black quarterbacks, man. I just look at them as quarterbacks, which is interesting. Now I looked at Warren Moon as a black quarterback.
Right.
I looked at James Harris as a black quarterback and stuff. But now it's sort of like commonplace. It's
past tense.
Yeah, it was so, you know, back then, you know, they had, Marlon Briscoe, a few guys. They played quarterback.
Randall Cunningham.
Yeah, right? Randall. Well, There were guys before him, but I'm talking about when I see James Harrison, all those guys and stuff. Those were black quarterbacks, Ben. And Doug Williams
was still a black quarterback,
right? Because Doug was, in that sense, the first, you know, he was a black quarterback that played in the Super Bowl and won and dominated, right? But after that, it was like, you know, became common.
Right.
You know, it's almost like when, I'm sure, like Willie Lanier was the first, you know, middle linebacker and stuff. Man, I got a black middle linebacker. Well, now he's just, we got linebackers. I got, you know, we got some good quarterbacks and stuff. And I don't, listen, I always try to look at people as human beings. And I don't, you know, I think one of our challenges today is stop looking at color and stuff like that. And people are kind of overemphasizing that. I think
we have a very similar, like, upbringing, you know, in California.
I always tell people, this is, I love being black, right? No, you got to understand this, right? This is a movie from, I think it was Guess Who's Coming to Dinner.
Oh, God.
Great movie. It was so ahead of its time. I want you to think about this, guys. So I'm paraphrasing, right? So Sidney's talking to, or his father's talking to him. Obviously, he's disappointed about the relationship. And he says, son, you don't know what you're doing. You never made a mistake like this before. You've been nothing but a source of pride for me and your mom your whole life. And now you're just going to throw all away. And I think Sidney says, shut up. And he says, you can't tell me to shut up, not after what I've been to you. I carried that bag 75,000 miles, right? And you're just going to throw it all away? And then Sidney said, if you carry that bag 1,000,000 miles, you did what you're supposed to do because you brought me into this world. And from that day, you owed me everything you can do for me, like I will owe my son if I have another. And then he says, Dad, you see yourself as a colored man. I see myself as a man. See, I think sometimes if we see ourselves as black men, we limit who and what we can become or who we are. I'd love being black, but I don't walk around. I walk around as a man first. Treat me,
right?
You know, respect me because I'm a man, not because I'm, you know what I mean?
Right.
But I love being black, but I don't walk around. And I just think it's important to, you know, I mean, especially now, I think.
Yeah, we need more of that.
Yeah, because I think it's sort of being, you know, it's so negative, I think, what's going on and stuff. And hopefully we can sort of, you know, get beyond color and stuff. But sometimes it's used for an agenda and to manipulate and to... And I don't think it's as bad as everybody thinks it is. I mean,
it's mindset, right? Mindset is everything.
Well,
with everything.
It's the same thing when growing up, you know, when you have... you know, when you have cheerleaders in the house and
good
stuff.
Parents,
and you got
man.
Parents who just say, man, I can do anything, Marcus. You know, hey, work your butt off, stay out of trouble, and you can become anything you want to become. Mm-hmm. And that's how I grew up. And so that's how I sort of live now. And it's like, you know, and those, one of the worst words in dictionaries, can't, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then obviously, you know, I think, you know, this whole race issue and stuff like that, it's unfortunate. It seems like it happens every election.
Yeah.
Every 2 years or every 4 years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's kind of sad, but I just see them as quarterbacks, and I think that's a good thing.
Yeah, it's amazing.
I understand what you're saying, though. It's like, you know, you see a variety of guys out there, a little different than what we've seen in the past and stuff, and guys are dominating, but
right.
I just see them as quarterbacks now because I think it's mainstream.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah, they're not anomalies, you know what I mean?
Last night or yesterday afternoon, I just saw Dak Prescott as a dominating quarterback. That's all I saw.
Yeah, of course.
That's all I saw.
You're a Cowboy fan. Wow. Living in Vegas with your Cowboy jersey on.
I have adopted the Raiders, though. They're my second team. They're my second team.
Yes. You
know, I've always been a player.
So, tell me something. How do you grow up? You know,
I can explain.
Thank
I can
you.
Explain.
If anything, man, I thought you grew up a Ram
right.
fan or something
I can
like
explain.
That, man. Come
so,
on, man.
Back in the day when Dad was really popular, we had Dodger season tickets in the dugout section, right? So we go back in the locker room after a game. We're saying hi to Tommy Lasorda, and Tony Dorsett is in the locker room, and that was all I needed. I met Tony Dorsett, and they were like, yeah, he plays football. I was 6, 7 years old. And I was like, he's a plays for the Cowboys.
Oh,
I was
that's
like,
so I'm funny because
I'm a cowboy.
I saw Tony the other day too, and he told me to say hi. He was asking about you, John. He said, "What's that kid doing?"
Yeah, send my best.
Exactly.
Got one more, and then
I'm doing very well on this. By the way, okay.
Marcus is number 33. Is retired by USC.
That's a true or false question?
True or false.
Oh, wow.
Ooh,
I'm going to go with true. Yes.
Yeah.
That is true.
Okay.
So what, I mean, obviously, what got you back to 32? Was that a choice? Or
dude, first of all, I think 32 is one of the greatest numbers in all of football, right? So I go to the Raiders, and I'm not thinking about any particular number or anything. But Kenny King has 33. And so when I got to my locker, there it was, man, laying over my chair at number 32, dude. And I had a big smile because I was like, I said, one, it's a great number. Mm-hmm. Two, Jack Tatum wore it. And, you know, I wanted to make it famous, too. So that was my mindset. But I lucked into that one, man. Well, no, I should say luck. That was part of the master plan.
Yeah, exactly.
Because exactly. It's like, come on, man, all the great, the Juice, the Franco, they got Jim Brown, all of them. I mean, 32 was the hot number, right. Man, yeah. In sports. So,
what did you wear in high school? Or did you have a number?
Number 9.
Number 9 in high school, okay.
Yeah, number 9 in high school. I don't know how I got that, but, you know.
Yesterday, I actually made a remark. We were watching a game, and I was like, that guy's on defense and he's number 32. It was weird. I don't remember what team it was.
Well, they had a linebacker, guys, when I was growing up named Mike Curtis that played for the Baltimore Colts. He wore number 32, and he was mean and nasty and stuff. And that was another reason I liked that number too, though, because he was such a good player. Because we grew up, we had this, you know, I have 4 brothers, and we played this family called the Kirkendalls. They lived down the street. They had like 9 brothers and stuff like that. So we would always play them. And we were the Baltimore Colts, and they were always the Green Bay Packers and stuff like that. So, and you know.
That's funny.
That's awesome.
We'd kill them.
Who did you play against that you were like, when you knew that this game was coming up, you're like, oh, God, this guy hits hard.
Nobody.
Marcus Allen.
Marcus didn't get hit.
No, no, no. Let me tell you. You get hit. I mean, sometimes, obviously, the ones that appear to be, you know, like, oh, my God, he's not going to get up, you usually do. They don't hurt. And then there's some you get hit, and you're like, what? I don't even, you know, I look on film, and I go, like,
how did that hurt?
Yeah. You know, where did that happen? I can't even recognize it. And I'm like, you know, I'm dying, right? It's like I got a hip pointer against the Denver Broncos. I'm looking on film, and I can't find where it happened. But it was right on my, you know, my bone, my hip bone right there. Right. It was like the worst bruise. I mean, I coughed. Anything I did, it was absolutely just so painful. So that prevented me. I wanted to play, but they didn't let me. When we played you guys in, you guys, you're a Raider fan, but we played the Washington Redskins.
Uh-huh.
Can I say this too?
Yeah.
Washington football team.
Washington football team, you mean?
Back then it was the Redskins.
Yeah, we played the Washington Redskins. And so I didn't play that game. And they ended up beating us. Like, it was a high-scoring affair, like 38 to 35 or something like that. But I didn't even play. I came in for actually one play. Was a special team play on onside kick or something like that. And but I kept looking on film, and I couldn't see where it happened, but it was like killing me.
That's funny.
It was killing me.
Do you think today's game is soft compared to when you played and with the rules that are in place? I mean, obviously, for safety, but.
No, I don't think the game is soft. I think it's the rules have certainly, I think, you know, were designed to protect guys more. We were a little more violent, a little more aggressive,
sure.
A little, you know. I'd like to think that we, you know, we play the game as purists would like to play it, you know. I saw, actually, were we together? Yeah, we were all together watching the game yesterday. And they got Lockhart, Is it Tyler Lockhart?
Yeah.
Well, I played with his dad, see, in Kansas City. On a crackback, I was going like, what? That was awful. I mean, it was like he didn't even hit him. It just like, so it was like in the vicinity, you know? It's like it's like almost a double play ball.
Yeah,
he
was, yeah that's like near the base. That doesn't work anymore.
Yeah, it was like near the base, so they called it, you know, they called him out. Like, dude, he didn't even touch the base. He was near the base. He was in the neighborhood of a crackback, but it really didn't crack back on him. I'm going like, see, that wasn't good.
Right.
I understand they're trying to protect players, but come on, let them play
let
football.
So
in the vicinity. I know you had a lot of those in the vicinity.
Oh, my God. I played shortstop. Are you kidding me? I think maybe 9 out of 10 times I wasn't on the base. Come on. I got to get out of the way. Yeah, I'm trying to get killed.
I've seen him now, man. You just like, you can just barely, you know, just you don't even touch the base, but just looks like you do or just close to it.
What do you think about
the calling the guy out?
Why we brought up baseball, you know, my favorite sport. But what do you think of this? I meant to ask you this. I almost asked you the other night. I was watching a game the other night. There's a guy running to third, and I think it was the Dodgers playing, whoever they were playing. Okay. Guy slides into third. He beats the ball, right? And the player, third baseman, puts the tag on him, but he beats it, right? But his momentum on the slide
takes him off the bag.
But not off the bag, like sliding past the bag, just like the natural, like your left foot.
Like
hits
this, like lift much, right?
And it lifts this much, and the guy keeps the tag, and then they go to instant replay. And
they call him out.
And they call him out. Like, I kind of think that's a bullshit use of replay. Because but he beat the tag. He beat the ball. He beat the tag.
Yeah, but you can't come off the base, period.
Ah,
you got to be in touch.
It's like, so if this is the plane of the goal line and you don't get there, you're close.
Yeah.
You know, you can put the index card in between.
Yeah. Okay, couple things before we go.
Hey, we're going to need some courses with you.
Yeah, right. I just think it's chicken shit.
Some of the rules and regulations.
We don't need to stop the game for that and go like whatever. All right.
I think obviously the team that you
got fucked on that call.
Right.
Yeah, so that's why it blew my parlay. Jesus,
there you go.
There's a hidden agenda.
The truth comes out.
It's not biased. Go ahead.
Before we go, couple things here. We've had a very long ongoing debate on this show.
Yeah. Oh, jeez.
Before you go there,
I know where this is going already.
Before I go there, what?
I feel like we had this conversation with Marcus.
No.
Marshall.
It was... Marcus was there.
Marcus was there.
Marshall's birthday at the San Diego Casino?
Yeah, and we had this...
No, that wasn't. That was on... I'll tell you what that debate was, and they punished me bad. I made the mistake of asking... I think he was there. It was you, Kenny Lofton. Kenny Lofton was there. Marshall Faulk. It was for Marshall's birthday at some casino in San Diego. This is 10 years ago. And I said... better athletes, baseball or football?
Right.
And I think he didn't even want to talk to me. I think Marshall was like, are you out of your mind? Football. And then I thought I had backup with Kenny Lofton.
Right.
And Kenny's like, football.
Right.
I'm sort of surprised by the question.
Here's why.
Is that rhetorical?
Are
you delusional? Seriously, they even think that they're in the same
league
athletics.
He's just talking about jogging in the outfield.
I know. Here's the thing. This is actually a better setup to the next question. But hand-eye coordination, right? Hitting the fastball coming in, whatever. And I always say this. If you take a baseball player and you put him on a football field, if I take Brady Anderson, put him on a football field, and I go run a route, he can catch the ball, he's going to look okay. Okay? If I hit most football players a ground ball at third base, they're going to have a fucking meltdown.
Wait, what? No? But you think, what are you saying that, I mean... Are you saying...
John, what are you saying?
You're just getting a great athlete who hasn't played baseball?
Yeah.
Just to go, I mean, are you saying that if I train him for a little while, you think they would look foolish?
Let's use Michael Jordan.
I can go out there...
Okay.
And... you talk about football players, he's a basketball player, so he's eliminated.
Okay.
Hey, but I can go out there and do a Brooks Robinson at third base, man.
But you played baseball.
Right.
I guess to me, it's like
so. But okay,
if you're an athlete, you're gonna qualify. Just jump.
You got to say guys, these are the guys who play both. Or at least say that, right? Yeah, then yeah, we're better athletes, but they can't come out and play football.
They can't.
No, hell no.
not the game.
Not I would say not baseball.
Everybody
but football.
Thinks they can.
Okay.
Well, actually, even Charles Barkley. You know, he thinks he would be a great tight end. And I said, Charles, listen there, linebackers would send you a limousine to play against you every day.
Right.
Let me ask this. So what about LeBron? Would LeBron be a good
He's a different specimen. I mean, yeah, he could be an amazing tight end and stuff like that. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. I'm pulling up. So last night, this segues to this, actually.
Maybe young Charles, maybe, you know.
Not current Charles.
Yeah. I'm skipping my question. Well, I'm skipping the debate.
He would be in the line of scrimmage. Yeah, yeah.
I'll circle back to him being the final ruling on this ongoing debate, and we'll put the debate to rest in a minute.
Okay.
But I got a text from my longtime friend, Travis Woods, who you've met years ago. I played high school baseball with him, played Little League baseball with him. And my friend Travis, I told him, he's a huge Raiders fan, I told him, hey, I have Marcus Allen coming on the podcast tomorrow. And he writes, I'll just read it. He says, with no glasses, he says, you're such a royal million-dollar asshole. I have that guy all over my Raiders wall. I love Marcus Allen. So I said, all right, well, I'll tell you what. Ask me. I'll give you one question. What do you want me to ask Marcus Allen? And he said, how does he view Bo Jackson as an athlete and as a Raider?
Phenomenal athlete. Phenomenal. Rare specimen. Like Herschel Walker. I mean... rarely do you see guys with that kind of size. I mean, what was Bo? 235, 24? I don't know. Yeah. He was probably a little bigger than people gave him credit for. But just flat out fast. And Herschel, same thing. I mean, just country strong.
Really?
I'm seriously.
Yeah. Well, when he did bobsled, I was amazed by that.
Herschel from the South.
Yeah.
And just for name, you know, just amazing talents.
Yeah, Herschel.
And it's so funny. We all get together and we laugh and joke and stuff like that. And to think of all of us are Heisman Trophy winners and stuff like that. And we, you know, we have a good time.
Now, have you been to the Heisman House? Is that a real thing?
The Heisman House?
Yeah. All these commercials for the Heisman House. I always see these things.
Yeah, you didn't get your invitation?
I did not. No. I was the extra one again.
Seriously. Yeah, they wanted somebody to hold up some, yeah. They needed some extras in the background and stuff. I
get that one either.
Your name. No, yeah.
The Nissan Heisman House was not. Yeah.
Okay, last two things and we'll let you go. So the ongoing debate.
Anyway, amazing talent.
Amazing talent.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Golf.
Yeah.
Sport, or is it an activity? An activity that requires a lot of skill. Is it a sport,
or is it an activity?
Sport, thank you.
It's not an activity, dude. That's a sport.
Thank you.
He's been debating this with every pro athlete he knows.
Let me tell you something. Running the ball at the goal line with 11 unblocked men is easier than golf.
Damn. Wow.
Come on.
Oh, yeah. It's
damn.
It's not easy,
wow.
All right. I told you I'd give him the final ruling.
Yeah.
I will acknowledge golf is a sport moving forward now.
I love it.
Okay. Marcus Allen gave me the final ruling. All right. Last thing before we go, I've got an Emmett Smith football signed by Emmett.
Right.
I have an empty Raider helmet.
Yeah.
Would you do the honor?
What time you guys got right now?
It's 11:05.
Huh?
11:05.
11:04. I stopped signing. I'm sorry.
We will see you next week, Marcus Allen. Thank you so much for doing this, my buddy.
Of course.
Thank you, man. We'll see you next time. That's classic.